Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It is Saturday, March 19th, 2016. And we actually got quite a bit of work done the last couple of days. So let's open up Visual Studio and just get right into it. Obviously, it's a bit late today. It's going to be a bit of a short stream. At least it's what's planned. Said the same thing a couple times recently, ended up going long, but oh well. Okay. So this here gets the closest player start, and using it, try to figure out what the direction is, but we found out it was just kind of glitching around a little bit. It was sort of working, but not quite. So we're going to end up having to do at some point is fixing our rotation, which is, which one? It's camera move, camera rotations. Here, actually. We're going to have to fix this at some point, such that it accepts an initial value. Because for some reason it was overriding. Yep. So we'll have to figure that one out at some point. That's okay. Let's spawn in. So as it stands right now, every time we spawn, we're gonna face world relative zero for y'all, which is fine. There's not really much else we can do about that, but that's okay. So if we don't have a spawn point set, we'll spawn in the center because that's what ended up happening. But if we do have a spawn point set, or whoops. If we do have a spawn point set, going to the right level, which we will do through menu, we will actually, I don't need that anymore. We'll do a new standalone game, sure, why not? I need to fix the UI such it doesn't break like that, but you know. So here we have, let's say we choose player one there and AI for that one. We're gonna start at spawn one, which means when we launch a game, the game's gonna launch, and we're gonna be at spawn one facing world zero. We can then rotate however we want, of course. Our code isn't that broken. It knows what it's doing when it comes to actual in-game. It's just that no matter what we do, we have to face world relative zero until we fix that. But yeah, we have that now, and then because of that, we now also have this information. We now have this information, which is a player slot. Which, actually, I think is, yeah, here. So, we have this information for each player, including AI, and including disabled. So including AI, did we include disabled? I don't think so. I think we, I gotta check that. There. Our player slot. Configure players. That's a good question. Did we? Huh. I don't think we actually checked for that. That would be a bug. Yeah, I don't think we checked for that. So, the way I check to see if we check for that is to go into the test level here. And in the level blueprint, actually, we don't need to do that. It's already going to print that. We can go into here, launch the game, and try disabling the spawn. Will it add? I'll do spawn disabled on separate teams, even though it's an extra check. Yeah, it actually does do the disabled. Is that something we care about? Actually, it is something we're going to need. I was going to say we can pull it out, but it ends up being a good bug, because now that we have disabled, we're going to use that data to despawn all of the pieces from that player. Not spawn number. Yeah, okay. There we are. So that works. Whoops. Gotta close that down first. Okie dokie. So, yeah, actually ended up being something we need. So in game mode. Sorry, not menu game mode. We need, let's actually close that down. Let's close down the menu stuff. We don't need a menu stuff up. Close that. So we need that, we need that. We need these. Piece, I need. Base game instance. Tile normal, I need. I don't need you. I don't need you. I don't need you. Hey, welcome to the chat. So, in case people are wondering what we are doing here, back in November of 2014, I started working on a video game called Check It. And because of the whole music licensing issue, I wanted to have everything on YouTube, but I didn't actually have license for the music. So the plan was that after I do a demo, I would go back and redo it from scratch so people could see what it was like from scratch, right? And also I couldn't store the videos. Turns out it was just as easy as clicking both record and stream on OBS, but I didn't know that at the time. In case you're wondering, I'm waiting for a program to launch right now. So we made this game. And it was horribly broken, stuck to 1 versus AI and a whole bunch of other nasty stuff. But it was supposed to be a demo. And it was based on chess. And the first level here you're going to see is the chessboard level, but you'll notice that I said chessboard level as if there's multiple. So instead of 8x8, what's to say we don't have a game like this? Where you have 64 by 64 grid, and not every tile is active, right? Which means that we have to do one minor change For the pawn, any direction could be forward. There is no direct forward because I don't want someone to go and move up and then have to move to the left but never be able to unless they eat, and then they can only eat one diagonal, right? Come on, cross streams, wake up. There we are. So here we are. This is a much larger level. Should be a bit more indicative of what I have intended. Then you can move the king, and as you move up, the area around it will increase. Well, the area around will increase unless you, you know, go out of range, in which case you're gonna see it decrease right there, right? So you can move up to the Fog of War, and you can move anything up to the Fog of War. So if you move the king over, again, and again, and again. Now we can select this knight and move it, but we can't select this knight. We can only select this one until we move one more slot over. And then we can grab it. And it's all turn-based, so it's all turn-based too, so it's not like a real-time strategy where you have the ability of time. You can take your time and think for each one. I don't know if I'm gonna make a turn clock or anything like that. That might be a future feature. So anyway, what we have now is an actual interface that lets us launch into the game, select whatever player we want, assign them to whatever one based on whatever the level is. That'll be a map of the level, and then we can spawn in and play. And we can also now have the camera rotate on diagonals, because, you know, that might be useful. And the circle and or the sphere and the cube are just there so I know which tile is which. Okay. Oops, that's a weird little glitch there. Didn't drop any frame, no, okay. Okay, so now we'll go to a tile. So I set the dynamic material, yeah, so I can create, so I have a material for the tile and for the aura. Actual tile itself defines what that parameter is. Okay, so I'm wondering why. I wonder what's causing that to disappear when I make it dynamic. I because it shouldn't actually do anything. I have my post-edit change property actually literally do nothing. It's common just so I know which color is which. So yeah, let's see. Let's save. Now if we click the tile and we make it dynamic, then it disappears and I don't really know why. And it still disappears until I actually reset the level. Oh, I got the problem now. It's because I define post-edit change property, but I don't actually call super. So what I'm doing is I'm saying on editor change, do nothing. But it should do something, so yeah. This should work now. So basically I'm, compile failed. Oh, yeah. That should be it. I don't remember having to do that for any other post-edit change property, though. But that did solve the problem. Make it hidden in game. Let's try running, and we should see this sphere be hidden in game. I think it actually should be that way. Oh no, it's up. There we are, and it's hidden in game. Okay. I was gonna say, I don't remember having to do that in the original check it. However, I did have some issues in the original check it with setting some things and not having it work. Alright. Let's look at code. Visual Studio Code. Tile. Oh, no, I had to. Yeah, okay. So I was just remembering bullcrap, because clearly, if my old source code has it, I did it. Okay. Well, that was fun. Fun and lightning. Right. So now we can... yeah. actually, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to quickly check on whether I can get the exact property from post. And the reason why I'd want to do, I mean, it's an editor time, it wouldn't matter. But the reason why I'd want to do this is so I only update the property that changed. But again, it's only an editor time. I don't really care if it takes like 3 seconds to, well, even though it won't take 3 seconds, it'd take like 3 frames max to change something. Yeah, it's a UN type, and it's what? Oh, and this is the one I couldn't find out, right? I had to look it up in editor. Do peak definition? Oh, whoops. Peak definition. Definition of okay. Apparently that's a heavy operation. There we are. So property change type, unspecified array add value set, duplicate, interactive. It's actually right above it. Yeah, I'm not gonna bother with any of that. Okay. Okay, so when we change property, this is one of those times where I'd want to have this pinned, and I don't know why I did that when I need to actually do that. So be enabled. Is active, else tile is hidden. Didn't drop any frames. I guess that might have just been a skip in the song. Let's see. I'm curious now if it was that player skipped or if that was a song. Sounds like the player skipped. Yeah, the player skipped. Weird. So, if be dynamic. Tile can be changed at runtime. Else, tile is static. Lighting, shadowing, etc. Let's actually see if we can get a more... Let's try a song. So if it's enabled, dynamic. Okay, that's shutter again. Is my graphic card driving? Or a driver crashing? Well, if I blue screen, you know why. I'm not sure if it's coming up on stream, but twice now it flickered with a... Looked like an HDMI cable was disconnected, even though it's not HDMI, it's a DVI. I don't need to change the location that's set by the editor. I did it again. Probably should reboot my computer soon. I think actually enabled and disabled. Sorry, enabled and dynamic is the only one I need to do, so. Let's do that. Let's go 0.F. And then be hidden. Equals false. Let's see here. And allows only to be seen in there, so it says set to actor hidden in game. Okay. Actually, let's see. Let's run the thing so. Okay, so dynamic, this is where we start changing, this stuff here, so, tile mesh, cast dynamic shadow. Is that correct? Oh, it's backwards. And we're actually going to do a new function, bool can shadow. So bool a tile can shadow. Return true. So, so the idea behind this is it's kind of a cutoff switch. It's just gonna return true at all times, unless I change it, and that way I know that anywhere I need to do shadows, it will, instead of saying true, I can flip this to false, and it will shut it off anywhere. But if the effect I want, like, I never wanted to cast a static shadow because it's a dynamic object, then it'll just automatically be false. Even though it won't really matter too much because movable can't cast a static shadow, but you know. I think it's only for lights, right? Yeah, only applies to lights. And this will be cast shadows, if it can shadow. But this will be false. At all times. Tile mesh, cast shadow equals can shadow. And at some point, I may actually want to have more logic to this, but yeah. Let's do a hot reload. So then when I set disabled, it didn't do anything. Oh yeah, sorry to hear. Okay. So this is what I want. Now I need for the, so in normal tile. So we're actually going to want to save, so we're going to want to save on the tile instance, a slot for that. So, view property. It's just so we have something to target. So F linear color. Um, base color. And then we will save it. Appear monitor spring up again. And it'll be aura color or glow color. And this way, when we have it in here, we will have aura color, sorry, glow color equals. Oops, there we are. And now we do base color and blue color. I was wondering if there's a way I can make these two instructions be on the parent, and there is, by messing with the, probably messing with the super, but, maybe? I don't know, and even then it's two lines, I can just make sure I add to each one. So now instead of this, new glue color. And now I'll set it to whatever the glue color is of any given tile. So if it's not tile normal, because tile normal inherits from tile, then it will be whatever it is. And this is a base color. It'll be M tile material set vector parameter color base color base color. And then I'll do M tile material. I'm thinking it's not an opaque shader we're using, so value base color. Color, but it's not gonna matter because it's not gonna be visible in it or in a game anyway. So it should make the tile be black. So let's do a hot reload. Oh, she crashed. Have fun. It's probably because it didn't, it's probably calling, skip restore. It's probably calling glow color and base color without the constructor, even though I thought the constructor was restored. So yeah, let's go here. Dynamic, whatever's fine. There we are. And game mode's off. Okay. Because in game mode, it's visible and, you know, it's set to be hidden in game mode. Oops. That's right, that's the one. Okay, so let's try another one. Is that one from Varian just a couple seconds ago? Oh, here it is. Okay. So the reason why we want to have dynamic tiles is if in the game we're going to have some tiles that'll be affected by a catapult or a drawbridge or something, we want to have those tiles be dynamic so we can turn them on and off. We could technically also move them as well, even though we're not going to move them, but just so we can turn them on and off without affecting the rest of the scene. Because if we were shadowing them and they were static, the light maps for the rest of the level would assume there's a shadow there, so we disable the object and there'd be a shadow casting from nothing, right? Now, we still don't really have good shadows being made, but, you know. Okay. Okay, now as I said, we're gonna be spending this time. I know this is the time we usually quit, but we've only been at it for 50 minutes today because I started like an hour and a quarter late. 45 minutes, more like it. Let's start here. So this is player spawn one, I believe. This is player start one, this is player start zero. So I was wrong on that. There we are. Now, if we place pieces in the level, in the test level, let's give it a queen, let's give it a pawn, let's give it another pawn, let's give it a knight. And these all have spawn number zero, so that's fine. Now if we go over here, we will add a bishop, a queen, a pawn. I thought aiming down would make it more easy, but apparently it's not. Hey, and we will change these all to spawn number one, spawn number one, spawn number one, spawn number one, and spawn number one. So these will be all associated with this spawn, and these will be all associated. I thought I had an extra pawn here. These will be all associated with this spawn. So whenever someone creates a character here, we're gonna spawn a king on where the spawn is, and they'll have access to these pieces. The other team will have access to these pieces. one thing we need to do is change the actual team. Face pawn, whoops. Peace pawn. Where did my solution explorer go? There it is. Peace pawn. Okay, this is not really making sense to me immediately, so let's go into material and see what happened. Peace base. There we are. So the parameter color is this. So piece half height. So I didn't actually set anything dynamic. I just, yeah, okay. Okay. So, U property, whoops, I was on caps lock for some reason. Edit anywhere, blueprints, read, write, category equals actor settings, F linear color, team color. So we're gonna, for now, add a function. Void set team int 32 team number. So here we're gonna define it now. This will be between piece clicked and that's so void a piece. Set team, in 32, team number. If team number equals 0, we'll do team color equals, where did I have that? I think only in the editor, as I just said. So, actually, open up a trusty notepad. There we are. So we'll have red, green is 0.335871. 335871. Blue is 0.0435. And alpha is 0.0 because, well, yeah. Okay, so now in Visual Studio, we will set the initial team color. Which actually is above half height, but whatever. Equals F linear color 0.725F 0.335871F and 0.0435F. This will be our team zero color, because that's, well, that's gold. So there, that'll be else if team number equals one, team color equals f linear color. Let's see what a good color value for this would be. You want to desaturate. Let's try 0.7. We do not want to save that. Okay. So if linear color is 0.7f, 0.7f, 0.7f. Else, let's make it a nice fail color, team color equals f linear color 0, 0, 0, 0. It should be smart enough to not do that, but yeah. Oops, there we are. There we are. Then we'll have to do, whatever that tile thing is. There we are. So M piece material. And what's the parameter called again? Base color. Is that right? Yeah, right one. Color is team color. Let's just rename it to base color, just so it's more consistent. This will be piece material. And then base color here. And again, it doesn't know what that is. It doesn't know what team it actually is. All it knows is what spawn number it is. And the spawn number will map the team based on the player slot. As a matter of fact, in the game mode, we want to actually make a method that looks through the player slot and returns the team number. But yeah. Ooh, jeez. Not really liking it when my screen starts flickering all over the place. And again, I'm not dropping in frames, so. There we are. So now we need to This is gonna be very dirty. Yeah. Can you set a parameter? Or is it immutable? I think you can set a parameter. Yeah. Let's not do color more space color. And then you do post edit change property. And again, I'll have to give that structure. A piece and be super post edit change property property change events and then allow upstream and then we will do set team oops. Actually, I'm gonna do that. Yes, this doesn't even need to be done. I just need to make sure that on begin play, I set the appropriate team. Set team spawn number. All no, I don't want to apply any changes. I was just messing around with the editor. Okay, let's rebuild. And now when we place items in the world and we assign a different spawn number, it should go to the it should change the piece color to that color. Although in actual game it will be assigned to whoever the team, whatever team the player is on. These ones are 0, and this one's 1. There we are. And then we're gonna need to figure out a bunch of different base colors or other shader changes. We can do more than just change a single color in a shader. We can have as complex of a shader as we want and have a couple booleans, couple of vectors that we can change according to that, even make it like pulse or whatever. Or whatever else, right? As long as it's not like a texture. I mean, you can technically do dynamic textures with that, but that's probably, it seems like loading a texture would be pretty slow, and the point of this is to be quick. You'd think in that case we better just swap the material entirely. Who knows? But, yeah, so we have it set like this right now. And, yeah. When we join the game now, we'll need to have the game mode, get the player team, and then set all the pieces that color. I would probably need some way of having the player know which one there is, because as it stands right now, okay, so here's the problem. As it stands right now, when you assign a player to a team, all of the team pieces will be the same color. If you have multiple players per team, do we want them to share all the same pieces, or do we want the pieces to be independent? So if spawn zero is one player and spawn zero is the air player, yeah, we'd have to do it that way, actually. Yeah, so we need to find some way of separating the team colors based on the player. The easiest way I can think of is if the we have 10, let's say, whatever our max player count is, base colors, and for each of those base colors, minus one, because as we go further up the ladder, we don't have to care as much unless we let them choose a color, but we don't have that set up yet. Whatever, whatever we decide, we then have slight variations on that, so that that category of colors will represent a team, even though they're all individual colors based on the spawn number. It's an interesting design decision, but yeah. The other thing I can think of is if we have an aura and the pieces you own are under an aura and every other one doesn't have an aura, or if your pieces don't have an aura but everyone else has a shroud or something like that, just so you can know which pieces are yours or not. It's just a UX thing, or even have like a void going over the top of being like, this is this player's, this is that player's. That's actually even, might even be better. So the pieces are all the same color, but there will be an indicator over each piece to say what player specifically it is. That will let us make do with fewer middle colors or other shader variations. Currently it's all pure metallic, but we could change to whatever piece material we want, really. We can have some plastic pieces or whatever. It really doesn't matter. We'd have to change the material, of course, but we can change it to whatever we want. I'd like to stick with just solid colors for now. Solid colors up to the material. Like if we have subsurface scattering, technically that's not a solid color because the scattering angle would change it, or the Fresnel or whatever. But that is still based off of a single color, right? Basically, I just don't want to involve textures going in and out because I don't know how quick Unreal Engine would be modifying a dynamic texture parameter. I know it's pretty quick modifying a vector or a scalar parameter, or a couple of them, or a Boolean parameter, whatever. But an actual texture you'd think would be pretty heavy. So we can check around with other people, see if that's the case. If that is the case, we need to go into Blender, we need to UV map our pieces, because they're currently not UV mapped. With anything sensible, I should say. Everything has a UV map, it just could be like a dot. yeah, that's a thought for another time. For now, though, I think that's going to be it. So thank you for watching, and we'll see you next time.